said he was going to be on. Can we go ahead, Brad, or do we need
to wait? Yes. No, you can go ahead.
Okay. This is a committee meeting for fire and safety. I see that our two committee members are on. Gary, if you can confirm that you're here?
Yes. Yes.
Nick, are you here?
Yes.
Okay. And I do see, I'm going to go ahead with the roll call so that if anybody else wants to get on, Marini, his, I don't see. Keith Zaire?
Yes, I'm here.
All right, thank you. Alan Hips?
Here.
Jen Donsalski? I know she's not. Brad's here. Jennifer's not. We have Chief Buss and Chief Zolgas.
Yep.
Yes.
So, the purpose for this meeting was to go over the additions that we were going to, that was suggested for the chief to add on to the fire engine. And he did send over on November 2nd a breakdown on that in hopes that if anybody had any questions, they could go ahead and reach out to him ahead of time. So at this time, Chief Buss, I'll let you go ahead. And Jen Domzalski just joined us.
Good evening, everyone. I think our last meeting was really good. We got to go over quite a bit. I took all the information that was discussed. I brought it back to the committee that was put together. And I asked them, what do you guys really want? And that list of items I came up with and I sent out to you, mainly the power locks and windows, obviously as convenience. The command zone electrical system, they call it. I know Councilman Wojtas mentioned electrical issues can be a problem with trucks over the years. I believe this system helps diagnose and isolate electrical problems when they occur and is an integrated electrical system. So there was some thought this would be an advantage. They added back in some storage in the cab of the vehicle. That's the transverse cab storage. And I asked them about size of the truck and some other issues like that. And the committee really felt the size of our fire truck as it is now and about the size of our trucks as they sit is good for the roads in our community. We can carry the equipment we need. And there was actually concern the bigger the truck gets, the more difficult it is to handle and less maneuverable. And it was pretty much the group that these were the items that they'd like to add. And the only other thing they wanted to put on there is the 4% contingency in case something comes up while they're building and say, hey, we need to add this, or, this might be a nice feature to think of. So I put that in there. I didn't hear back from anyone after I sent the email out. So I would ask, does anyone have any questions or looking for further info? Nothing?
I have nothing at all.
Okay. I have talked to Jennifer, and she's looking at a couple of ways of financing or paying for it when we get to that point. She's not here tonight, but she's well aware, and she has a couple ideas she's looking into. The interest rates on if we lease it through Pierce are right around 3%, just north of it. She felt that was a competitive rate. So I'm not sure where the next step, Brad, is where we would go with it is if legislation needs to be drawn up and we put a reading or two in November and December here, or where we would go next with this. With, again, that goal being ideally to put in an order January 1, in January at the latest for this.
Chief, what do you need for us for Pierce to go ahead and confirm that we're going to be able to get this price? You need a letter that we're going to vote on this, or what do we need?
I believe it's the legislation that it's been brought up, it's been approved, and it's our intent to purchase it. They have formal letters of commitment, but I believe talking to them, once they see.
Right, Jason, for this type of purchase, we would want legislation for something of this expense and commitment It's my understanding when we get to the council meeting that we are going to cancel the next November meeting. That would be the night before Thanksgiving. So if we're going to go ahead with it, it would be something that would be introduced at the December meeting and considered at that time.
Yeah, okay. Let's get this on the first meeting of December.
So Brad, I would then at that time, it's just when we have our regular meeting, when I go into my committee chairman report, I would ask for this to be added onto legislation for December?
Yes.
Okay.
And then in that meantime, I can get all the particulars from Pierce to get to Brad. So he has it.
And we should be able to override the three reading because we have all council reps for the last two meetings. So it should
Be. Yeah, we can override that.
Right. And I just think there need to be some discussions and thoughts, that it's going to be fit into the budget and what the priorities are and that type of thing. So I think, Jason, you would need to get this ordered by the end of December, right?
Ideally, that would be great. I believe their next price increase is January 31st. January 31st, one was February 28th. When we were looking at Pierce and Sutphin. In any case, ideal December would be even better to get the ball rolling on it.
Right, because I know the mayor and Jennifer had some concerns about what the governor was going to say today and whether he was going to close the casinos and racinos. He did not do that. I doubt that is going to happen. I mean, I think the state makes too much money off of them. His speech was concentrated on businesses where people don't wear masks, to make sure anyone that enters a retail business or is working in a retail business are wearing masks. And he said there may be some consideration in the near future as to restaurants, bars, and gyms. People have difficulty wearing masks, so I don't anticipate anything changing at the MGM. Little bit concerned about the spike and how that was going to affect us.
Well, Chief Buss, I want to thank you for you getting that out to us in plenty of time. That gives everybody a chance to look it over so that if there were any questions that could have been addressed with you ahead of time. So the tutorial tools ahead of time really help so that we have all that information so that all the question and answers can be taken care of. So I appreciate that.
Okay. And Jason, just once you get the quote, just get it to me and we'll work on the legislation.
Okay.
And then once meeting, it would be December 9th. So you just need the legislation passed and then you could go ahead and turn that over, right? Right, Jason?
Yeah, I believe I'm looking through their packet right now and I believe that's what they would need.
Yeah, I think the Pierce was the price increases in February, but in order to get the current price, we had to put the order in like 30 to 60 days prior to the price increase to lock it in or something like that.
Well, that would
I think it was 30 days is what you guys said the last time.
It's 30 days, but if you get it wrapped up at the end of the year here, that would be great.
Well,
I have a question. What kind of price increase would we be looking at working on half the budget that we've had in the previous years? And this is quite a big expense. And I just hate to go out and spend $700,000 and have a spike go all the way into May of next year is what they're calling.
When we're looking at it, actually, the first payment realistically isn't going to be due until 2021. And broken down, let's say we do it for 10 years, we're looking at about a $65,000 a year, was it? Yeah, $65,000 if we do it over 10 years. But the first payment can be done the first year it's delivered. Or you can actually defer it 1 year later. So we're looking at a payment in 2021 or 2022. And I know it's hard to sometimes keep it in that actual first payment's gonna do, You do just because of the long time on these.
Right. And Jason, I thought you guys said that the increase would be what, 3% or 4%?
It's 3%, I believe, is what they have here.
Yeah, 3% on
$600,000, so $18,000.
Jason, didn't you say the first payment was due in 2022, not 21, right?
Correct.
Because you just said 21. So
it'll probably 22.
Yeah, that's.
That's what he said.
Depending on delivery of the truck.
Yeah, right now they're a 10 to 12 month build time. So if they got ahead of schedule, there is a chance it would come by the end of next year. But it's going to either be, it's going to be 22, because at that point we could say, okay, we're going to defer it 6 months if we want it, to make sure it shows up in 22. So if we don't want a payment in 21, we do have the option to make that happen.
And I think that might be one of the options that we ought to consider, because we still don't know what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
It's and as everyone knows here, I'm not worried about COVID, but the rest of the country is, and the rest of the state is, and a lot of our people are here in the village. I just want to make sure we don't react too quick here, because if we can get that payment, not on 21, I'm telling you, the way they're talking today, they're talking 20 May that we're going to have this problem. I mean, he can shut these casinos down in January. Our order's in. We're done. We could never afford it. What's the penalty if we order the truck, they shut the casinos down again, and we can't afford the truck?
Well,
I think
Nick,
the options that we have to look at.
Well, one of the things you got to consider is you're looking at a 28-year-old truck that should have been taken out of service three years ago. Truck doesn't meet any of the standards of today's fire trucks. The truck is unsafe.
Gary,
the truck needs
I'm talking about what you are saying.
I understand that. I understand that. And as the chief has says, we're not even going to make payments until after the truck's being built. And we're talking a year for the truck to be built. So we're talking at least the end of 2021 before we even have to make a payment on it. If it comes early.
And I think we need to. Early. I think we need to know. Let the people know that we do have two trucks, and we're going to delay the payment as long as we can. Because I know right now, if I was making a purchase for a vehicle for my house, the way that the work is going, I don't know if I could do it if they shut us down.
I get that, Nick, but I am behind Gary on this one. No, I mean, we have put Band-Aids on this for a couple of years now, and I'm hearing from the residents that why are we still waiting? Why are we still waiting? I understand that we have to worry about finances, because one of our big money makers is we don't know what's going to happen with COVID. I truly am behind Gary on this one, that we can't put this off. This is something that it must go through for our village.
What is the payment? I'm just throwing out all, you know, pros and cons on this. I know we need this. We've already been through all this, but if we order this and they shut down the casinos until July, and we have barely enough money to keep our payroll going without furloughing, without layoffs, what is going to be the penalty if we have to cancel this truck or move it to the next year?
There's a question. We can't. We have been putting this truck off for quite some time. We can't cancel this truck. That's the worst thing we could do. Not only for our citizens, but our firefighters that are using the equipment to be able to keep them safe also. So we're looking at $65,000 payment a year. That's what we're looking at out of an $8 million budget.
No, we're not looking at $8 million. Gary, you aren't listening to what I'm saying.
Okay, let's go back with
$3 million budget for a year, we couldn't.
Okay.
We'd have to talk about that then. Who are we laying off?
Absolutely. We'd have to go back and look at where we would have to change our funding to. But that's what we'll have to do at that point. We're not at that point yet. We can what if the whole entire situation forever. I mean, what if this COVID thing wipes everybody out and there's nobody here. I mean, we could do that all the time, but we have to look at going forward and we have to look at doing what we need to do. And this is something we absolutely need to do. And we can adjust as we need to down the road.
So Nick or Councilman Magistrelli, to answer the cancellation question, purchase price after the order is accepted and entered into the company. 20% of the purchase price after completion of approval drawings, which that'll probably take about a month. And then 30% of the purchase price after material requisition. So I'm guessing they got the vehicle on the line. And then as the vehicle gets built more, it's like that fee can increase as it goes through the production line. Is here in their contract. So to me, it looks like as the vehicle is built, the price escalates.
Right. And essentially, we've been obligated to buy the truck. If we defaulted on it, there's that default runaways in the contract. And, if they sold it to someone else, whatever the difference was, we'd have to be responsible plus some of those other penalties.
Okay. All I am is throwing out scenarios here. I'm not trying to start a confrontation. I'm just, if they close that casino down, where are we going to get the money from? Have we thought about that? We canceled the building for the fire department, and we canceled everything we could to try to keep money into the coffer. Now we're making a $700,000 purchase. I just want to know, have we thought about, if we go back to a $3 million budget, how are we going to pay for it? And it's not
that the number would be over six, nothing over $600,000 for that truck.
Right. I had a number of 700, but it's still very large purchase.
Yeah. Well, absolutely. But you're also,
if you take into account the financing, Nick, it's probably is 700. I mean, not quite 700, but
with the interest
with the financing.
I'm throwing out here. We need the truck. We know that, but we don't know what's going to happen here. It just seems like.
But it is $65,000 a year. It's not something that's.
But we're looking at a vehicle that's going to be here for 25 years also.
I'm still got to throw it out there, guys. You kind of wonder, like, this is the way I run my house. I don't purchase nothing when there's big question mark of the future. So when I throw it out there, we've all worked together and we've all thought we've got a great crew here. I just hope we don't put ourselves in a position where we have to lay off three or four service people, a couple police officers, because we didn't wait an extra year. I just want everybody to know that's what I'm thinking. I'm not saying we don't need the truck. We know we need the truck.
I guess my concern would be there is if my trucks fail, it doesn't matter how many people I have working, we can't handle the emergencies in the community.
Right. Dude, we have a fire last week, didn't we?
We had one three nights ago.
Rosewood?
Yes.
Hi, Jen. Okay, I just throwing it out there, guy. I mean, I'm just...
the other thing I would say, Mr. Magistrelli, is so in my long-term budgets that I have sent to Jennifer, I've tried to plan for this in our capital. We've had items like we had to replace turnout gear. Those costs have been covered. With the purchase of the ambulance through the CARES Act funding, that's going to remove a long-term capital project from the fire department. So some of the long-term expenses we were expecting in the fire department, right, have actually gone away. We've been able to get the turnout gear replaced, the ambulance, that being replaced in a year. So the year the fire truck first payment will come due, we're no longer repaying on our frontline ambulance. So we cleared up that $37,000 a year. And when we're looking at the $60,000 a year or 65 over that 10 years, if that's what we do, in my current budget with the cap, it's there, it's already been budgeted for or planned for and not drastically increasing my standard budget. And I get what you're saying is that if we had to make cuts, it would be difficult, but it There's a few things I just feel we have to provide the service, and
I understand that, but we almost got to throw that budget out the window. You see what I mean? You can always say it was within my budget. Those budgets are gone after what just happened the last 9 months. We can't say it was within my budget. Those budgets have all been cut to nothing, you know, just to keep everybody working and benefits being paid and pensions being paid. And this is all I'm thinking about. And I'm throwing it out there so that we've cut back on so many things. What is it going to take to make that payment go to 22? You mentioned we can extend that payment.
The first payment isn't due until a year after delivery.
Right. I mean, you said that we could do that.
Which would put it in 2022 to begin with.
Right. All right, say we order the truck. The truck comes in. You said we could either extend the payment and start it afterwards or do it in 21.
The first payment is due 1 year after delivery. Okay.
So he's talking about 10 months. So that would be, the earliest would be October of 2019, and a year later would be October
2021. Renell, 2021.
Correct. You're right, yeah. I know what I want to say. What comes out
of
my
mouth? You just had surgery. Give her a tag here.
I'm past the surgery, thank God. But, you know, you figure 10 months, that brings us October 2021. Yep. And the first payment would be 1 year later, 2022, October, right?
At the earliest.
Correct.
So.
Okay, there we go. I mean, it sounds better now, but can you see what I'm saying? Can everybody kind of understand what I'm saying? You know, I wouldn't go buy a new car now.
Though, Nick, if you're at the point to where your car is always breaking down and your car is not going to get you where you need to be, and you need to update an awful lot to get your
car
back to where it's roadworthy.
I've been there, Gary.
Well, I'm just saying you're going to have to do something.
I know. I just want to make sure we don't put ourselves up against the wall. But that's all I'm saying. I just throwing it out there because I don't know if the idea of skipping the three readings might not be a good idea, but it's we'll decide on that when we come up to it. Because we got to get this order in by the end of that month, correct, Chief?
Yes.
Ideally, yes.
Guys, I'm not trying to be hard to get along with. I'm just throwing out those questions. And I hope everybody understands.
Well, I'm listening to Nick, and what does it take? And this is just the heck of it. I just want to ask, and I'm sorry that I'm butting in on your little meeting and that. But what is it going to take? Okay, what would it take to put that jalopy we got back into where we won't call it a jalopy, you know, where it's going to be able to do its job?
And so it's not a jalopy, but there's standards that we have to meet. And it's five standards old. It's a 30-year-old vehicle. Not any of us are driving around with a 30-year-old vehicle that basically we're going to risk or depend our life on that vehicle to operate properly. There's numerous safety enhancements for the vehicles. Quite frankly, a vehicle over 25 years is listed, it shall not be used for firefighting operations. And so we can use it. But if something goes wrong, there's a pretty significant liability on our part, knowing that we're in this situation. We've extended the vehicle. We can continue to try to repair it, keep it running. It works. It's just going to be a matter of one day it's not going to work anymore. And anytime a vehicle gets an oil change, goes out for service, we rely on our backup fire engine. And I have to make sure the vehicle's there ready to respond for the residents for every emergency as it comes in. And, you know, you don't get a second chance to respond to that fire or something like that if it happens. And, you know, from simple things like the braking systems to the handling to airbags, the way it's lit to the cancer materials are used to prevent cancer to firemen, there's just a whole host of array of changes that have occurred in the past 30 years that we open up ourselves to some liability there. It's a purchase that we make once every 25 or in this case 28 years for the vehicle to be replaced. If to put it in perspective, we'll probably replace 25 police cars in the same lifespan of this vehicle, and at $50,000 or whatever a police car is running, it's just a cost we're used to spending. We purchase a police car usually about every year for about the same price as this payment's going to be. So yes, it's a lot of money, but it's equipment required for us to do our job.
Is there anything else? Anybody else have any questions? All right, I'd like to thank our committee for coming in so that we could listen to the chief, and thank you for the rest of the council that was able to come aboard so that everybody has the knowledge for our December 9th meeting. I'm going to go ahead and close the meeting at 7:26 so that we can be ready for our 7:30 meeting. Thank you, everybody.
Ms. Nowak, you're going to make a motion to adjourn.
Oh, okay.
And is there a second by someone on the committee?
Second.
Nick. All right, Nick is second. So, Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtasz?
Yes.
Okay. Committee meeting is adjourned at 7:26. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
I need a refill.
1 Nexium.
I'm still waiting for a drink and I can't do that yet. Brad, is the mayor going to be joining us tonight?
Yes, I believe he is. I talked to him shortly.
Yeah, I talked to him this morning.
A little while ago, probably at about 6 o'clock, I talked to him. So I reminded him about the committee meeting. And
well, there it is.
Yeah, because I spoke to him this morning, and he said he was going to be here. So that's why I questioned it.
Yep.
You're Neil?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Rich Wasowski.
Hi, Rich.
Hi. Can you see me?
I can see
yes,
you.
Yes, we can see you, Rich.
Okay.
Hear you.
Okay.
You're actually doing it right this time.
No, I got the internet provider came and he changed my cable.
Ah.
They put me on fiber optics on my house.
You're moving on up, huh?
I tell you, our neighborhood here is moving on up. I'm the first one to get the fiber optics down my neighborhood.
Oh, wow. Good for you.
Yeah. How you been?
I'm just plugging along on a daily basis until the doctors give me the okay that I'm good to go back to work, you know? Oh. So.
Did you have the virus?
No. You have been out of the loop. I fell at the airport September 13th and fractured my hip in two places.
Oh, so God.
I am on a walker for 12 weeks with 30% weight bearing. Yeah, so
wow.
It's been, yep.
Oh. Now, have you had any of your joints replaced?
I've had two of my knees replaced. They should have just replaced my hip because that would have only taken a couple of weeks instead of this 12 weeks for just. Because what happened is the ball in the socket, the ball went up into the socket and cracked it in two places.
Yeah, my wife has both of her joints replaced in the hip.
And yeah.
It she came back real fast.
I have pins and plates and everything, so.
Oh boy.
Yeah. But thank you for asking.
I didn't know.
Yeah, you haven't been around.
Yeah.
Meetings have gone quickly.
Right. Well, If you go out to eat sometime, you got till next Thursday, I think, to go out to eat. Because they're going to shut down the restaurant.
Oh, I've got plenty of food in my house. Okay. Jennifer, that soup is phenomenal.
Oh, that's, I'm very happy.
Yeah, what I did is because I had so much, I put it in the freezer and, yeah, I love it. Thank you so much. And when I'm done, I'll bring you all your things back.
No need.
Hey, it's 7:30, guys.
Whenever you're ready, Mayor, 7:30.
Okay. I'd like to welcome everyone to the Village of Northfield regular council meeting on November 11th, 2020. Can you have the roll call, please?
Mayor Niehaus? Mayor Niehaus?
Rosen.
In time.
Mr. Magistrale? Here. Mr. Magistrale?
Here.
Mr. Zur?
I'm here.
Ms. Domzalski?
I'm here.
Mr. Hips?
Here.
Ms. Nowak?
Here.
Mr. Wojtusz?
Here.
Mr. Bryan?
Here.
Mr. Wazowski?
Here.
Chief Zolgus?
Here.
Chief Buss?
Here.
Mr. Walters?
Here.
And I am here.
Can we get the approval of the minutes of October 28th, please?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Nowak, seconded by Mr. Scherer. Any comments, questions, amendments? Hearing none. Mr. Scherer?
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtusz?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
Minutes are approved.
Okay, moving on to reports of municipal officers. The mayor at this point doesn't really have anything besides what was going on down in Columbus today with the governor. As you all heard, I think he's pretty much threatening to shut down restaurants and bars. It looks like from what I heard tonight. And wear a mask and no groups greater than 10. So that's going to affect a lot with our recreation stuff we want to do. But we'll get down to recreation again. Finance Director, Ms. Pop.
I have no report this evening.
Engineer, Mr. Wasowski.
First thing, I just found out yesterday, Ohio Edison replaced one of their power poles at the northeast corner of Ledge Road and State Route 8, where a traffic control box is for that intersection. The pole mm-hmm. they replaced is where our power is connected to. So when they get that transfer all taken over with all the wires in it, the electrical, telephone, and cable, we'll have to transfer our power service to the new Ohio Edison pole. And the way the rules are formulated for these situations is the last company working on the pole, the old pole, the abandoned pole, has to remove it. And the last company that most likely will be working on that pole is us, the village, for the traffic signal power. So besides transferring the power over, which means installing some new conduit on the pole and new wiring, we're most likely going to have to take that pole out and fill in the hole. Signal service does that sort of work all the time. And that's who I recommend doing it for us when that comes about. So far, Ohio Edison has not contacted me about the situation. I was up there today in the village, and I noticed, you know, the pole, their new pole is up.
Rich, excuse yes? me. Do you know what the cost would be to take that pole down? An idea?
I'm figuring it's going to cost at least $2,000, probably up to $3,000 total. That's for transferring over the power and removing the pole and filling the hole up. But Rich, the signal service will give us a price on it when it comes to that.
Rich, I don't remember. Why did the pole go down? Was it old with the storm or somebody hit it? Or
no, nobody hit it. They're just replacing, well, two things are happening now. You're not here in the area generally, Brad, but they're replacing a lot of poles now, older poles. They're just putting new poles in, and that's just normal maintenance. The second thing is, if I think everyone's noticed how many more cables we have hanging on these poles. All these overhead cables for the TV companies and communication companies, that adds a lot of weight to those poles. So suddenly the smaller lightweight poles can't handle it. And you have to have, this pole is much larger than the one they just replaced or replacing. So that's just something that's going to be happening. And I wouldn't be surprised someday to see most of the poles on Route 8 being replaced if they keep hanging more of these overhead communication cables on there. And anybody just go down Route 8, and if you can remember what it looked like, say, 15 years ago on Route 8 with the wiring versus what it looks like now. And it's night and day. It's just a lot of weight on those poles now. So
yeah, I just wasn't sure if we had an insurance claim to charge it against. So, okay, I understand.
Yeah, we don't have any. Yeah, nobody hit it, no.
Hey, Rich.
Yes?
Rich, what's the consequence of not removing that pole and just leaving that pole there?
To me, there's
instead
really
of spending the money to remove it, what will it hurt by leaving it stand?
It just puts another object in. If somebody did jump the curb, you know, driving their car, and then they lost control of the car, like they lost control on the other side of the street and hit our pole on the other side of the street. If they lost control of the car and they hit a pole that really shouldn't be there, they may have some claim against you that you left an object in there that was a known hazard. And maybe if it wasn't there, they wouldn't hit it and they would have been okay. Or their car would have been okay.
That would be an answer for our legal there.
Yeah, that's something Brad would have to look at. As far as performance-wise, if you just leave a wooden pole there, it doesn't affect the operation of our signal or anything. Once we transfer over to the new pole.
So, yeah, I don't. Thank you. Unless it violates some specific traffic code standard, I don't think we would have any liability, Gary. I mean, we'd be
okay.
Immune. Unless there's some specific, like I said, under the traffic manual that it violated.
Thank you.
See that Houghton Road and Borderman Road asphalt milling and resurfacing. I got the final bill from Carvo Companies for the milling and resurfacing job they finished up last year. You know, we keep a 1% retainage for a year. The 1% of the year is up. And the job was accepted, so they're due that 1%, which is $1,553.18, and that should be paid as soon as possible. Summit Soil and Water Conservation District annual MCM6 inspection. This is an inspection that now is done every year. It's a mandatory inspection with the agreements we signed with Summit County. And with the EPA. Jason and I are involved in these inspections, and we go around to the service department at Houghton Road and the old treatment plant area where we used to store a lot of stuff. And they check it out to make sure that we're complying with all the environmental requirements. And they always issue some faults that we have that we should try to correct, and we generally do correct most of them, but we'll see what they do this year. Now, these inspections, they want to start doing those on a quarterly basis, you know, four times a year. But right now, it's only mandatory once a year. So hopefully next year, they'll keep it once a year also. So Jason and I will take care of that. Anybody wants to come and see one of these, 10 o'clock a.m. on November 24th, that's right before Thanksgiving, that's when we're doing the inspections. And we're meeting at the Houghton Road Service Department for the start of the inspection. Dollar General Store inspection by Summit Soil and Water. The contractor for the Dollar General Store, the new one on State Route 8, filed a notice of termination with Ohio EPA. Basically, that's a document they file saying they're done with the job and all the environmental stuff they had to adhere to during the construction of the job, that it's done, and the EPA doesn't have to worry about them anymore for construction itself. Well, we as a village normally inspect that with the Summit County Soil and Water. We have a joint inspection, but because of the virus this year, we got a waiver. Our waiver actually ended the end of August, but we got a waiver not to do the inspections on those with Summit Soil, and they agreed to do it themselves this year. And they have not signed off on the project. They say it's not complete because there's not enough grass growing around the area of the detention pond. And once they get enough grass there, which filters out materials entering the pond, they'll basically sign off on it, and that job can be completed as far as construction goes environmentally. Let's see, the next one is Beach Avenue and North Plaza Drive sanitary sewer TV inspections. The Regional Sewer District their report, I think it was like a 62-page report with their photographs on the televising of the sewers on Beach Avenue and on North Plaza from State Route 8 to about 500 foot eastward. And they also did the sewer that goes from Fell Avenue down to Houghton Road through the park. The Fell Avenue through the park sewer, it was pretty clean. A couple bad offset joints in there that the only way you can correct that, those really to dig up part of the sewer and replace it. And we're not doing that. But our service department cleaned that sewer out maybe 3 months ago, and did a very good job on it. So we were in good shape there. The Beach Avenue and North Plaza sewer, though, where it was in very, very poor condition. It had a tremendous amount of grease in it. And parts of it, it was hard, I guess, getting the camera through. In fact, the one part, they couldn't get it through at all. And we clean out that sewer on a yearly basis, which normally is fine. It's a good practice. But the grease, they're just dumping grease, and there was some rags in there, like workman's rags, like you'd find at a shop, like an auto shop or so forth. So someone or a number of people, either one, is dumping a lot of grease into that sewer system, and that just totally, it creates basically a dam in it, and you can block it up completely with the grease if you don't clean it out on a regular basis. Our guys cleaned it out. As soon as I told Jason, I think he got better the next day, and they cleaned it out and did the whole job on it and got it real nice and clean. But I suspect we're gonna keep getting that problem unless we find out who is dumping this grease. Now, that particular sewer, McDonald's dumps into it, Handles dumps into it, Firestone dumps into it, then some businesses on Route 8 dump into it, and generally grease is a problem from restaurants, generally.
Rich, can we backtrack that sewer to see where it's coming from?
Well, you can put a camera. The easier way, Gary, is to go to the grease traps. Each commercial building should have a grease trap in it.
Okay.
When the grease traps are put in, when they're installed, Summit County Building Department does the inspection of the installation. And
that's correct.
When they're put in, there's no problem. It's working fine. The problem is
they're brand new.
They're brand new. The problem is you have to clean them out. And people don't,
correct.
People don't realize that you have to clean those things out. And I don't know if you know, years ago, Gary, when McDonald's was up across from the racetrack, they actually, their grease trap filled up, and their sewer went all the way to Vincent Avenue. And that complete sewer filled up with grease. And they had to stop operations one day because they couldn't discharge anything. It was the whole sewer was clogged with grease.
If you feel that we're going to get cited or what have you from Northeast Ohio, we need to do that. We need to be entering this business, these businesses, and checking that out to see if that's being done.
Well, I talked to Jason about this, and I think we're going to have to go and check out, even though that's, I don't know if that's legally our responsibility to check them out.
Not legally our responsibility. It's Summit County Health Department that's actually supposed to be doing it, which I do call into Summit County. And I have talked to some of the businesses, which, of course, you're going to get yes, we take care of it. Firestone, I've gotten into it with them a few times over their shop rags. And I walked into their bathroom and showed them the rags that are coming into that. So this happened a few years ago. It's happened a few times. The business I don't specifically. I don't know what's going on there. But I don't know. I don't have a specific ordinance to this stuff as far as what we or how we handle that.
Okay, we'll have to contact the health department and let them take care of it then.
Right.
I think we do have something that Jason McCullers dumping into the sewer. Right.
You can't dump into a, especially the storm sewer, if you read our ordinance.
Right.
Look, but at the same time, there is that issue, that line comes right out of, you know, by the old bank building in Firestone, right down towards the police department, you know, town hall. And it dumps in right there, which when we were cleaning that out, even our police department came out on us and asked us, you know, I guess, the, you know, they had some fumes coming in there when we did get it cleaned out. But, I mean, it was bad. And we had just did it almost 7 months prior, which it shouldn't be. We used to be we could do them things even every year and a half. So now we got to bump it up again, and we will. I can tell you this, Gary, we are going to try to find – it's not easy working with the county health department.
They're sure.
Understaffed right now because they have a lot of people not working within.
Does that conclude your report, Rich?
Yeah, that's the end of my report.
Thank you. Law Director, Mr. Bryan.
I have no report this evening, Mayor.
Okay. Moving on to department heads, Police Chief John Zolgas.
Thank you, Mayor. I did email a report out earlier today. Sorry it was so late. If anybody has any questions on that, that's all I have. Unless if Brad, if you want Ms. Nowak to make those motions now or to wait till her report?
It's up to her now, whatever she prefers. Mm-hmm.
What motion?
Okay, great.
Thank you.
That's all I have, Mayor. I'm sorry.
Thank you, John. Fire Chief Jason Buss.
Good evening, Council, Mayor. Thanks again for having the fire and safety meeting tonight. As I sent out an email earlier this week to all the department heads, I do have three people out with COVID-19 right now that are firefighters. Many of the local public safety agencies are seeing an increase of members coming down with COVID. What's interesting about it is to find most of the cases at the hospitals or at the fire departments are not being linked to them on the job. It's birthday parties, weddings, social gatherings. It's being tracked back to that. A person's getting infected, they're coming to work, and then they're spreading it amongst coworkers. So just like the governor said tonight, it's the very basic things to kind of keep people safe from these. The storm warning up at the fire station is about 90% in. If you drive by there, you'll see the poles up. The electrical is on the pole. The siren's on top. We were just waiting for Ohio Edison to bring the meter in and do the final electrical hookups up to the electric on Route 8. So as soon as that's done, we'll do a test, and then it'll go on a regular test schedule. I'll have a Cordino signs, make up a nice sign so it's very visible for people driving by that they'll know that is tested. So that project's moving right along. All the various equipment we've ordered through the CARES Act, most of it will be delivered by the end of the year. It all should be delivered by the end of the year. We have the same backpack sanitizer and fluid that the company we've been using for the building. We now have a lot of that we can do in-house. So probably by the end of the year, going into next year, we may have one of my firemen take over that role of sanitizing offices, doing all that, since we have the equipment now. It's available, and so is the solution for the disinfectant. That was a problem before. So we're making some progress there. And then the last thing, on November 9th, we did have a house fire at 3 a.m. I believe everyone emailed everyone on council and the mayor that we had this fire. Our firefighters got there very quickly. We're able to knock the fire down within a couple minutes. The residents were already out of the house. It was a house that was being remodeled. So unfortunately, it's been difficult so far to find an exact cause. It doesn't look suspicious at this point, but firefighters did a great job at the fire. No one was hurt. None of the firefighters were hurt. We received assistance from Macedonia, Oakwood, and Valley Fire District at the fire. So I appreciate all of their help. So that event went very well. The house did receive some damage, but they should be able to repair it. And I know the mayor had one other item he was going to bring up in rec, but I'll briefly touch on it here. We've been discussing back and forth on what to do for our annual Santa Claus in Northfield Village. And listening to the governor tonight, unfortunately, as much as I've been a part of that event in the village for 21 years now, we're probably going to cancel that event. It would be over the 10 people. What I said about firefighters themselves coming down with COVID-19, it just doesn't seem like a worthwhile risk to get a firefighter sick at what is a good PR event, but I got to make sure I keep paramedics and firefighters on the vehicles responding to calls. So I believe the mayor is going to discuss that a little bit more in his recreation committee. As it looks right now, we're probably going to push to cancel that event just with the nature of how everything's going. And I would anticipate in December, it's not going to be that much better than it is right now. That is all I have tonight.
Hey,
Chief, I have a couple questions.
Sure.
With the portable sanitizers that you now have for the fire department, you guys can also go down and do the police vehicles.
Yeah,
when they
should be able to drive them by. It's the exact same Victory backpack sprayer with vital oxide.
Great.
We just got all that equipment in this past week, Captain's.
Right.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that, you know, it's not only going to be utilized for the fire department, that we can utilize it for the police department and, you know, basically everywhere in the village if we needed it. And the last thing I had also was, I know you talked about canceling Santa Claus. Just consider it, maybe we can do just a drive-by that Santa drives by and waves to people in their homes. You know, where they don't come out to the truck or they don't come close to people, but maybe at least they could see Santa Claus and give them some kind of cheer. And just an idea.
That's not a bad idea too. I mean, like I said, Gary, and you've been around a long time with me in the village, and
it's an event we all look forward to and participated in. And if I can salvage part of it, I'm up for trying that. I'm still working on that.
Okay, just want to throw it out there. Mm-hmm.
Okay, moving on to Service Building Superintendent, Mr. Walters.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. Big thing for us, we're in the middle of the leaf pickup. As everybody can see, we still have a lot of leaves in the trees. This is the first year we got to pay to get rid of leaves. So the best deal we got was with Boyas. A little over $100 a load to dump. So the big thing is just, you know, with the leaf season and then getting the same trucks ready for plow season, we usually do a week per ward. This year we decided all wards are being done. So we're going to just go through, and where we leave off that day, we start the next day and then go back, and we'll keep going through that way. But its cutoff is December 4th. So, you know, we tried to get that out there. So I'd ask council if they get calls or neighbors, whatever, people asking. We can't keep it going forever. You know, at that point, you know, if they could bag up their leaves or whatever, but we're not going to continuously keep coming. December 4th comes, it's over. And honestly, I can't afford to just keep going and paying to dump a load of leaves. So,
Jason, where are you now in doing the leaf removal?
We are on the west side of 8 in the like Tree Street area.
Okay. Thank you.
We'll be coming back to like your side again, Rennell, which we went through there once, you know, so, and we're just going to circle through, but you know, the front streets like Gen Street, or you get in like May each, you know, all through that area. Those are the heaviest populated tree, you know, leafs. Kind of plaza really can run through pretty quick. Even some of them piles look big, but they go quick. It's the heavy, big leaves and piles. Obviously, when we have dry weather, it's really easy. That machine, you know, the heck of it really becomes dust. You know, so that it takes forever to load, and that's what we want. But when you get the wet leaves, like we had rain last night, it slows it down. Obviously, it's Veterans Day, but that's what we're gonna do, and that's why we're gonna do it. So I think it's going okay. It's a shame, you know. It used to be. But there's so many regulations now on the dumping, keeping leaves in piles. That's basically what it led to. The bank building will be getting toward. We had to have that survey done. There was some evidence of a small evidence of some hazardous material that was going to take out. That was reviewed today by a company. Quote should be to us. In fact, I probably already got it in the email sometime tonight. So we'll look at that tomorrow to get that. We'll have to get that taken care of so we can get moving forward to get the building removed. I think that's really, Rich touched on the sewer jetting of the beach and everything. Otherwise, I think it's going well. Chris has been getting trucks ready for winter, getting them. The frames and everything treated too. We treat them, you know, just to try to prolong things best we can. And so that's basically it. And the last thing I have, if everybody didn't know, this Friday, November 13th, Rogers begins his vacation, and that's his last day. He'll finish out his vacation as of December 31st, Roger. So last day officially, and as of January 1st, he is retired from the village. Roger started right around the same time I did. Long story to that, but the bottom line is Roger's been a very good employee. He's been very loyal. Doesn't ever, it's like a guy that you can always count on. Never once did you know, you ever get any kind of misbehavior from him as far as like back talking, like that. He's just a very good person. We're gonna miss him. I think the guys don't even realize how much that old man does. You know, they kind of, the younger guys, they're about to find out though. So,
Jason.
So, yes.
Hey, if you guys have a retirement party or anything for him, can you let the mayor and council know about that?
Well, just to let you know, I mean, Roger's been at, I don't want to have, and he's kind of a,
right.
He's not in the, he's, it's not so much his, but his wife's severely concerned over the COVID things. Okay. But I have, just so you know, I'm taking the whole department for Roger. We're going to be at Spinato's for lunch Friday. We might be there a little longer. I was going to get to that, but you know, I'm going to buy Roger lunch and kind of just kind of, you know, a little send off to him. We're getting a card, and you know, everybody's going to give in the department, we're going to do like 20, 25 bucks. People are going to get them like Cabela's or something like that. You know, Roger does like to hunt and stuff. So.
But well, at least let him know the mayor and council appreciate him.
I will do that. Thank you.
And Jason, really, can you tell everyone about the water line issue, just so everyone knows?
I'm sorry, what was that?
The water break.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. Houghton Road. If for those that didn't know, we had a pretty severe water main break on, oh my goodness, was it last Tuesday night? Anyhow, it was severe. It's right on the side of the road at the bottom of the hill, like right in front of the park, you know, right at the flattest part down there. Before you would get to, like, anybody would know where Linda Bone is, and, you know, but after our park entrance down in that flat area. A lot of damage. Our road was just done. It ended up being like a bomb hole there. Just a lot of material out of there. Went down there to see about getting our guys to fix it, realizing real quick with what we had, and it really shoveling it out of the back of a truck and doing it without a paver, it would have looked bad. Ended up in about 10 inches of asphalt back in there, but put a lot of binder course under that so we could have a good stable repair there, and it sealed off. Had a asphalt curb kind of done into it, and then, like, you know, next year if we choose, we can cut that out and put, you know, for the concrete curb. Just wanted it done before winter comes. And I had the emergency repair. We had Mid-Ohio come out, and they responded quickly the same day. They were in Cleveland. I made that call. Mr. Parker from Mid-Ohio Asphalt came from Cleveland, checked it out, called Brad, Mayor, Jennifer. Everybody agreed, and we just got it repaired. So it was
– So at this point, Jason, we need approval of voice vote from council to pay Mid-Ohio Asphalt $7,600.
I'll make a motion to make that payment.
Okay. Motion by Mr. Vojtich. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Hibbs. Any other questions on the motion? Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Vojtich?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
Motion is approved. Thank you.
I appreciate that, counsel. With that being done, that does conclude my report.
Hey, Jason?
Yes, sir.
Do you know what type of water main break it was? Was it a joint failure, or did the pipe actually crack?
From what I was told, they thought the joint had failed, but I get a comment. You know how that works, Rich. I had like three different answers, but it was by the time they got there, I mean, you're talking about a mess. It was a, you know, our water line on the side down there, kind of way it, and by the time they got there, I didn't get to see. It was at night. And by the time I got to go talk to them guys, they were already well in, which luckily they did respond quicker than we have seen them before, you know.
Okay.
So usually I get a report, Rich, you know, how they'll send us in and they kind of give a
– Right.
But I haven't got it yet. So, you know, I think that, you know, like anything else, we've tried before and sometimes successful, something. I'm definitely going to try to remit that and try to recoup some of that repair. Yeah,
they should pay for the patching, the asphalt patching. They should, the water department should pay for that. They're not going to pay you for the backfill, though.
Yeah, I know. They, like I said, it'll be a portion, but anything will. So we'll do our best once we get to that. You and I both have fought with them over that before. So
yeah,
it's sometimes a lengthy process, but nonetheless, we'll try. A lot of the little ones, we go get them repaired. You know, a lot of times, no different than some of the patchwork we do. But this mm-hmm. This was a substantial one.
Okay.
That's all I have.
Okay. Portsmouth Municipal Board and Commissions, Mr. Hips, the Planning Commission.
No report decision.
Recreation, I just want to kind of hit on what the governor said. We can't have more than 10 in a gathering. So anything that we have planned for Christmas or anything like that, you have no idea how many people would show up. So we're going to have to cancel those events. I don't know how else to put it. We'll try to work something out with Santa going around town. I'll talk with Jason Busmore about that. Kind of sad. I don't want to cancel anything, but I feel like we have to set the example as a government agency and follow the governor's order. So. Cemetery board did meet November 3rd. Some of the things that we talked about was changing the fee schedule basically for the graves. I think they wanted to go up like $100 or something like that. Also, we talked about the internet there. They have Windstream currently going to move to Spectrum for $76.97 per month. We're waiting on the install for the next 2 weeks. We also talked about Medical Mutual, which was had a 7.8% increase for the cemetery and its employees. And then we also talked about a new website, which we have a 4-year contract for $500 setup and $995 per year for hosting and software use. They're also still repairing the fence. I don't know if you've seen what they're doing there, but they're prepping the fence. They're doing a really nice job. And then painting that fence black. There's also a bunch of tree work that's going on at the cemetery. They have 2 or 3 really big trees that are dying and decaying. So we want to get those out of there as soon as possible and replace them with another tree. And that's all from the cemetery board.
Mayor, do you know, are they planning a meeting next month?
They have not set a meeting. With Jeff, it's kind of weird because he kind of goes by the seat of his pants, which I do not like at all, being on that board, because it's kind of like he tells me 2 days before that we're having a meeting, and I don't really think that's quite fair.
Can you bring up at the next meeting, I've had several people approach me that their gravestones have been there for 3 months plus, and still have not been put in, and nobody is getting back to them to let them know what is going on.
Really? Okay, I will contact him tomorrow on that, because that's a big deal.
I appreciate that. I could get back to you.
Do we know how many people actually called about that?
I personally, when I went to church last week, there were 3 people that approached me.
And how long has it been?
They have been, their stones, they have confirmed the stones have been there for 3 months. And nobody has gotten back to them to let them know when they're going to be set. Now, I know now, with the way the weather's going to change, it's not going to take place. But they deserve to have some kind of a reply.
I agree. I will get with Jeff tomorrow on that.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yep. Okay, report to the standing committees. Mr. Magistralia, Finance.
No report.
Roads and Public Works, Ms. Domzalski.
No report.
Health and Welfare, Mr. Scher.
No report.
Wages and Working Conditions, Mr. Wojtasz.
No report.
Gary, would you like to do the resolution for the collective bargaining now, or would you like to wait till legislation?
Actually, we might as well just wait until legislation.
Okay. Fire and Safety, Mr. Nowak.
Yes, Mayor, I do have a report. The Fire and Safety Committee did have a meeting at 7 o'clock, and very happy that the whole council was present for it. It was just to go over additional items that are going to be added to the fire engine that we've been speaking about. And I would like to bring up at this time that we would like to have legislation brought into effect for the next meeting, which would be December 9th, for the purchase of that. If we may.
The problem being right now is me and Jennifer have been talking about this. We have no idea which way COVID's going right now. We have no idea what's going to be shut down. We at this time feel like we need to kind of pump the brakes a little bit.
Mayor, we've pumped the brakes a lot on this truck. This truck is almost 30 years old. This truck should have been replaced over 5 years ago. This truck is not up to current codes, up to current safety conditions. We're talking about a year for a build on a truck, and a possible first payment of not even being until 2022. I don't feel personally for the community and the firefighters that have to use this vehicle that we have to wait or can wait any longer to purchase this.
I agree.
We're talking, as the chief had said during our meeting, we saved a lot of money on an ambulance. We're making some final payments on the other ambulance. We've saved a lot of money that way through COVID, and we're ultimately looking at approximately a $65,000 a year payment for approximately 10 years. So it's my opinion and my vote to go forward with this.
Well, I would like to have more discussion with the finance director and see where she's at with this.
Okay, so are we able to at least put it on legislation and see if it is going to be requiring a 3 reading and things of that sort, because we would like, for those that, when we were at our committee meeting, there were pros and cons, there was give and take, but I would like to see it on legislation so that if it is approved, you know, that we could see where it's going to go, so that Chief Buss has that availability, that if we don't have to have the 3 reading and you and Jennifer can go ahead and speak, but I would still like to see some kind of legislation so that if it requires additional, or do we want to have another meeting a half hour beforehand? I just can't, because we're only going to have 1 meeting in December because of the holiday. And
what the problem is, if it says go 3 readings, we're past the deadline.
Right, exactly.
It can't go the 3 readings.
And I don't think it's going to for
understand. I get it.
I don't think it's going to for those that are in favor of it. But we have been talking about this and talking about it. And now it's time that
I know, but the governor just today is saying that.
I heard him too, Mayor. I heard
you know, and this is where we're concerned, and you have to understand why we're concerned.
I understand. I totally do. But just as you know, Gary said, we keep putting this off, and I just don't think we can put it off any longer for safety and health for so many reasons.
I agree. You know what? I mean, I understand we have absolutely no idea what's going on, what's left or right. And you know what? Like, I just got a phone call tonight that my kid now isn't even going to school like she was as of Friday. And then next week is different, but then they're on break. It's a day by day thing. And I get it. And for someone who is so OCD organized, it's like driving me insane. But I think, in my opinion, this is not something that we can be like, well, COVID. Then we add a COVID something else, because the safety has to come before anything else. And we've pushed the limit on this engine. And if we have to cut baskets, and we got to cut this, and we got to cut that, and we got to cut that. We can blame that on COVID, but I'm not willing to blame a house fire or a broke down engine or a slower response on COVID. That is not something I'm willing to do.
Thank you, Jen.
We can cut.
And the chief was saying that, you know, that other truck is, it could be a liability because it's been in the fire department too long already. So guys got to consider that it may become a liability, and we don't want any broken down fire trucks at a fire.
And Keith, you're right, but to take it a step further, it's not that it could become a liability, it already is.
It is.
It is a liability.
Okay, so
these guys and women mean way too much to us and our village, and it is not worth all these other things where we can be found in other places, we can make up the difference. And we can. We absolutely can. If some resident wants to be angry because their street had to wait a minute, I'll remind them that in the event of an emergency, we made sure that was the number one priority, not making sure that you could lightly go around a pothole.
All right, cool.
Okay. I am not okay for putting this off. Absolutely not.
Okay.
Well, why don't we put it on the agenda then so we could figure it out and let the mayor talk.
So Brad, if you could put that legislation on for the next meeting, and then I would like to make a motion for the police vehicle that was in our agenda for this evening.
Yeah, and just clarify, Renault, that's a purchase.
That's a purchase of the 2020 Chevy Equinox LSAWD from Tim Lally Chevrolet for $22,515 with a $2,100 trade-in credit for the Impala.
Yeah, that was under the department head's report, but there was nothing in legislation.
Right, correct. So it's just Ms. Noack's making a motion, Gary.
I'd like to second that motion.
Okay, motion by Ms. Noack, seconded by Mr. Wojtasz. Any discussion?
This is replacing which vehicle? The Impala. What is that vehicle currently used for?
It's used for the Detective Bureau. It's at 2009, and it's going to start needing about $1,200 to $1,500 in repairs, and it's getting a high mileage. So we originally had $27,500 budgeted for a new car. Myself and Lieutenant Zajac, we started to go a different route and go with the Chevy Equinox because it was it's almost $5,000 cheaper. And it's going to be an all-wheel drive car as opposed to where the Charger isn't. So we're saving some money there.
So given our discussion about needing to find money somewhere else for budgeting for a fire truck, can we keep the Impala on the road, or are we just throwing good money after bad on that car?
Well, being at 11 years old, you're throwing good money after bad. It's going to be the new rack and steering. fuel lines.
Okay, but it's okay to, well, never mind. I'm not even going to get into it. With a $1,200 to $1,500 a month and, or a year in repairs, we could probably get another 10, 12 years out of it, but I'm not going to go that way.
No, I'm all for replacing it. That $1,200 and $1,500 is just in immediate repairs that would have to take place as soon as we could get it scheduled. And then who knows what's going to go. It's 11 years old. So
yeah, we've got a quarter of $1 million on a 30-year-old fire truck. So yeah.
Hmm.
But like I said, I'm all for replacing the police car if we need it.
Cut. Anyone else? Cut. I will call the vote. Mr. Scherer?
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtasz?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
The motion's approved. And Renell, just to remind you, I did not get it on the agenda.
I have that.
Okay. Yes, you want to go ahead with that?
Council, everybody should have received from Brad the breakdown that the chief, whoops, I lost you guys. That the chief, we've been discussing the watch guard, which is the taping and everything. And I would like to make a motion that was for $16,770.
Correct. And just to explain, and Chief Zolgus can add anything if
please
I miss anything, but this is the for a new server for the camera system for the dash cam and the body cam videos. We've had problems over the last year with things that have not recorded properly because the server is going out. So to me, this is a very important law enforcement issue, safety issue, evidence issue for the officers. So this is something that needs to be done. It's been discussed for a while with the finance department, and my understanding, Jennifer's okay with the purchase, and we have the funds to do it, and it is something that's critical and needs to be done.
Yeah.
So I'm sorry, guys. I got logged off. I had to log back on. I'm sorry.
It hasn't gone any further, Gary.
Yeah, just so everyone understands, this is the server that does house all our video and body camera stuff. It's the original server when we got this system back in 2013. It went into service in February of 2014. With all the upgrades that WatchGuard has done to the system, the server can't handle it anymore. And it has 16 hard drives in it. And when one fails, it just rewrites to the next one. Jay Mutter has replaced them periodically at $100 per, and we've probably spent about $500 or $600 recently, I believe. So Jay feels that it's just time to replace this before it just totally goes out, and then we're out of luck.
Chief, what account do you have that coming out of?
That's out of capital.
Okay. Yeah, it's $272,000.
Yeah, we're okay. Not even going
to. I'd like to make a motion to pass that and get that purchased.
Okay. I'll second.
Seconded by Ms. Nowak. Any other questions or discussion? Mr. Scherer?
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtasz?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
That motion is approved.
Thank you.
Can I complete report, Mrs. Nowak?
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, it completes my report. Thank you.
No problem. Mr. Hibbs of Buildings and Grounds?
No report this evening.
Legislation, Mr. Bryan?
Thank you, Mayor. First, we have resolution 2020-45, an emergency resolution requesting the Summit County Fiscal Officer in the year 2021 to advance to the village monies to which the village is entitled from the proceeds of tax levies for the tax year 2020. On first reading, This is something we adopt around this time every year just so we can get our tax levy monies as soon as possible next year.
Motion to skip.
Make a motion and I'll second that.
Motion by Mr. Magistrelli, seconded by Mr. Wojtas to suspend the three reading rule. Mr. Scherer?
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hips?
Yes.
Ms. Domsalski? Okay. Motion passes. Is there a motion to adopt?
Motion to adopt.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Wojtas. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Nowak. Any questions? Chair?
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hips?
Yes.
Ms. Domsalski?
Yes.
The resolution is adopted. Next, we have resolution number 2020-46, an emergency resolution confirming the mayor's appointment of Melissa Vitullo to the Recreation Board.
Wait. Motion to skip the three reading.
Motion to suspend the three reading rule by Ms. Nowak. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Magistrelli. Mr. Scherer?
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hips?
Yes.
Ms. Domsalski?
Yes.
Is there a motion to pass?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Domsalski, seconded by Ms. Nowak. Any questions? Mr. Scherer?
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hips?
Yes.
Ms. Domsalski?
Yes.
Resolution passes. Next, we have resolution number 2020-47, an emergency resolution approving the new collective bargaining agreement with the IAM. On first reading, I think everyone should have gotten my letter from yesterday afternoon outlining the terms of the new agreement.
I'd like to make a motion to skip the three readings.
Second.
Got motion by Mr. Wojtas, seconded by, I think Mr. Magistrelli yelled the loudest. and Mr. Scherer?
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hips?
Yes.
Ms. Domsalski?
Yes.
Is there a motion to pass?
Motion for passage.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Wojtas, seconded by Ms. Domsalski. Any questions?
I do have one comment. Being though as yesterday was the first that I even heard of this, of the contract even being talked about, which I knew was coming up soon, but neither here nor there. After talking with the law director on this, I reached out to the service department, and it seems that both sides seem to feel this is fair and equitable for everyone considered. Yes, so good job, guys.
Yeah, I would like to thank the third service department. It was a very fast and easy negotiation. I think they understand the circumstances we're faced with, and there's a lot of cooperation and understanding, and like I said, we got it done quickly.
Yes, thank you to all.
Okay. Vote for passage, Mr. Scherer?
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hips?
Yes.
Ms. Domsalski?
Yes.
Okay. Resolution passes. Next we have, and last we have.
Brad, can I say something real quick?
Sure.
Just wanted to say to everybody, you know, Mayor, Council, Brad, Potvin, without a doubt, I think it was a very good negotiation. Without a doubt, I think that everybody took into consideration the time that we're in and what's going on. Still, though, we do appreciate the village's side, and as always, we appreciate that our thoughts and everything are taken into consideration. So I appreciate Councilman Wojtasz. He did reach out, which we did appreciate. So thank you all.
Thank you. Last, we have resolution 2020-48, an emergency resolution authorizing the mayor to renew the village's agreement with the Legal Defender's Office in Summit County, Ohio for indigent representation in Stowe Municipal Court on first reading. And again, this is just the annual contract with them that we are required to enter into, no price increase.
I'll make a motion to skip the three readings.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Wojtasz, seconded by Mr. Hibbs to suspend the three reading rule. Mr. Scherer.
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak.
Yes.
Mr. Wojtasz.
Yes.
Magistrelli.
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs.
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski.
Yes.
Is there a motion to pass?
Motion for passage.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Wojtasz, seconded by, I heard, Ms. Domzalski. Any questions regarding this legislation? Okay. Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtasz?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
Resolution passes. That's it for the legislation, Mayor.
Okay. Is there any old business, new business, or announcements?
Yes, Mayor. I do have something. Today is Veterans Day for any and all. Thank you for your service and your sacrifices. I understand that the mayor would like to have arranged where the banners are going to start. The applications, he would like to start those on the 15th of next week. So I did reach out to Brad to bring up a new draft, and that is readily available. And then when we were doing the applications last year, we did have terminology on the back stating that we didn't know what the cost was going to be for putting the prior banners up for those that wanted to put them up. So I then reached out to Jason Walters and asked what the cost would be for us to put them back up with the service department. And he suggested that he felt that it was a courtesy of the village to just take care of that, to show our appreciation to their veterans. So we do have an application for those that would like to put them back up again, but I wanted to bring it to the council and see if there is an approval that there will not be a cost to our people that purchase them that would like to put them back up again, and just have the service department and the village sponge up that cost, because we're going to be on the poles anyway putting the other ones up. So any discussion?
I'd like to support that.
I wanted to say, it's, in my opinion, I mean, you guys are the department's being paid day to day, no matter. I just feel like, just as you said, we got to put anything up. It's a day's worth of work in a day. It's maybe depending on how much we got to do. But I mean, it would never be more than a day. But I've not seen it wouldn't take that long. To me, you know, there's a lot of compliments over those, I think, and a lot of people appreciate it. So I love that service, and I don't see any reason to charge for it other than when they have to buy their banner initially.
I would like to support that also.
Agreed.
Okay, and just to let everyone know, there's two applications. One is for new applicants that has the $150 fee, which covers the cost of the banner getting made, and there's a renewal application, so we have the information and know that they want the banner re-put up, but there's no charge for that.
And just so everybody is aware, Kempton will be doing it again, because in speaking to Jason, he has confirmed that the banners look phenomenal when they're, you know, for having them up since Memorial Day. So we are going to go ahead and use Kimpton again. And Kimpton, with COVID and everything, I was wondering if there was going to be any, and he's honoring the same price that we had last year.
Great.
I think the touch on the banner part of it, I mean, I'll be highly impressed if we get two. I can't see getting much more two. Definitely three would probably be a max before you start, because you don't want them up there looking raggedy, if you understand what I mean. We wouldn't want them to be up there looking beat up, you know. But right now, those things, it's hit or miss on how those stuff's going to look. But what we could see, they look great. And I see no reason to change.
Are we intending to take those down for the messier weather season and put them back up again?
Come down, they'll be coming down now that after today.
Okay. Right. Yeah, because the contract was up through Veterans Day.
Okay.
Yeah, the season
just
goes
checking on how long we intend to have them there.
Yeah, Alan, the season goes from right around Memorial Day to Veterans Day.
Okay.
Yeah, if we don't have them down by Friday, they'll be down by Monday, Tuesday, or next week. You know, so they'll be coming down. I think right now we do have it on the schedule for this week.
So are you saying that? I'm sorry.
We don't need a motion, no.
Okay, so do we need to reach out to see if everybody's in approval, or just we're all good?
We're all good. I didn't hear anyone objecting. Okay, this would be the time to do so.
Thank you very much, everybody.
For now?
Yes.
My brother was not hip to it before, and I want to get my brother's picture up there.
Okay.
And,
all you have to do is go down to Ledge Road. The applications will be down there. So all you have to do is just fill it out, and Elrod and Tiffany will be more than happy to help you with it.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you all, everybody. And happy Veterans Day once again.
Same to you, Ranelle.
Happy Veterans Day.
And then the other issue we shouldn't forget about, Mayor and Nick, it's my understanding we want to cancel the November 25th council meeting. That would be the night before Thanksgiving. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So if someone will make a motion to do so.
I'll make a motion to cancel that meeting.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Voitish, seconded by Mr. Magistrelli. Mr. Scherer.
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Voitish?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
Okay, and just to remind any press on the line, if they can publish that the meeting on November 25th is regular meetings canceled, just so all the public knows, we'd appreciate it.
I have a question about along those lines.
Go ahead.
I'm assuming we're just going to cancel the one on December 23rd. I mean, can we do that now? That way we can get it out there and it's out there for a little bit longer. So that way we hopefully make sure they know that there's only one in December.
Yes, excellent idea. And I think just to let everyone know, the plan is, you know, to try to have one meeting and get everything done in the first December meeting. And hopefully we can do that. If something goes wrong that we need to do something at the end of the year, we'll probably just have to schedule a quick special meeting to get that done for some other date. But hopefully that will not have to happen. So you going to make that motion, Ms. Zdolski?
Yes, I will.
And let me just look at the calendar here. It looks like it's
23rd.
December 23rd. Okay, good.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Domzalski, seconded by Mr. Magistrelli to cancel the second regular council meeting on December 23rd in December. Mr. Scherer.
Yeah.
Nowak.
Yes.
Mr. Voitish?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Ms. Domzalski?
Yes.
Okay, motion's approved.
Okay, no executive session is needed. Do I hear adjournment?
I'd like to make a motion for adjournment, please.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Domzalski, seconded by Ms. Nowak. Mr. Scherer.
Yes.
Ms. Nowak?
Yes.
Mr. Wojtas?
Yes.
Mr. Magistrelli?
Yes.
Mr. Hibbs?
Yes.
Mr. Madowski?
Yes.
Okay, it looks like we're adjourned at 8:39.
Everybody have a nice Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
You too.
Yeah.